The Congressional Hispanic Leadership Institute has these briefings throughout the year. I'm here on Capitol Hill, and we want to have these sessions so that they facilitate an in-depth conversation regarding different business issues, whether here in the United States or global issues, or as in today, here in our home island of Puerto Rico. We want to look at issues that affect not only the U.S. Hispanic population, but also issues that may seem not as a traditional topic for the Hispanic Americans. So we always want to make sure that we're at the forefront of bringing you some of the relevant issues. We're very proud today to have this conversation here on the economic development of Puerto Rico, as we are acutely aware of the economic, of how this impacts not only the U.S. Hispanic community, but even more important, all of the United States. First, a few housekeeping items. If you have your cell phone, please put that on silent. You can follow us on Facebook Live. You can also tweet about this to have others engage in the conversation. Our hashtag is TheChLI, T-H-E-C-H-L-I. We also have a number of people here or resources, not only from the panelists, but other people who have sent us information that we would like to share after this discussion today. So if you haven't registered, please make sure that we have your email. It could be just a business card as well, to make sure that we add you to that list so that we can make sure we send you any follow-up information. You also should have a handout in front that has additional information on all the speakers today, as well as the moderator. Again, we want to be thoughtful of everyone's time, so I'm not going to go through all of the information that's already on that handout. During this briefing, as well as many of our other briefings, as you are aware, we can never do these kinds of sessions without the support of not only our congressional members who are on our board and our corporate board members, but in particular the sponsors. So today, please join me in a round of applause for our friends at Amgen and Herbalife for their support. A couple of details regarding the format for today. So after we give the welcome remarks here, I'm going to pass it on to our moderator, Max Trujillo. He will start by providing a little bit of a background more on each of the speakers. He has some opening questions for each one of them. And then we definitely want to leave some time at the end for questions and answers. So if you could please start thinking about those questions that you may have. Also want to let you know that we're really trying for the first time, or a couple of times we've been trying to do this. We're actually live streaming this on Facebook Live. So if you can please be respectful with your questions in particular. I always want to make sure my teacher comes out when I start scolding you. So to make sure that we're all very thoughtful and respectful of the questions, our panelists, and those in the audience. So at this time, a couple of things. I'm going to go ahead and introduce our moderator, and I'm going to ask all of you for your help. We are supposed to be joined by three members of Congress, and obviously there's quite a bit going on the Hill today. And so as customary, all of you know, when we're making these briefings, we kind of take a pause whenever they come in so they can provide their remarks. We're expecting the representative from Puerto Rico, Jennifer Gonzalez Colon. We're also expecting Congressman Carlos Curbelo, as well as Congressman Darren Soto. So if you could please just give us a couple of minutes in between when they come in so that we can pause the program for their remarks. I want to thank a couple of people before we get started here, in particular the staff that put this all together, who are guarding the doors here, Nina Roque and Michelle. Marcia, Nina is the director of our programs in external affairs, and Michelle is our communications fellow, a recent graduate from Florida International University. Please join me in a thank you for them. And next we have some of our interns who are just finishing up their internship this semester, so I want to make sure that we do a little shout out for them, Alejandra, Fernando, Dominique, and Sol. Thank you all and congrats on your completion of your internship. One gentleman in particular who I would like to have a little special shout out, who always has some additional information on this topic, we had a chance to chat again this earlier, the Honorable Jerry Weller. Where are you, dear? If you can please stand. Thank you very much for joining us today. Okay, so now we've got the moderator who I'm going to introduce. In particular, I'm going to start by introducing his father. So, Mr. Trujillo, Daddy, is here. Thank you so much for joining us. He's going to be our Puerto Rico resident expert because he just came in from Puerto Rico. So you're on the spot, sweetheart. So Max Trujillo is the head of the firm MJT Policy, LLC, a government relations consulting firm here based in Washington, D.C. Previously, Max was the head of the D.C. office for Tonio Burgos and Associates, which is a New York-based government affairs firm. He handled a lot of the strategic advice for many of the clients there, not only for clients here in the United States, but in particular for some international business, including Puerto Rico as well. He previously served as a senior policy advisor for Congresswoman Nidia Velasquez and an associate state director for AARP in Puerto Rico. So this man definitely knows his topic here for today. He has also served in the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico's government as a deputy advisor to the governor and as a legislative counsel in the Commonwealth of Puerto Rico's House of Representatives. Mr. Trujillo holds a bachelor's degree from Marquette University, a law degree from the Inter-American University of Puerto Rico School of Law, and a Master of Law in International Legal Studies from American University's Washington College of Law. Please join me in welcoming our moderator and our Puerto Rico home expert, Max Trujillo.
Well, before we start, I think Marianne would like to know that the resident commissioner has arrived.
Oh, good.
And I will yield the podium back to Marianne. And thank you for your support.
We'll give her a chance to come up here. We're really excited to have the representative from Puerto Rico, Jennifer Gonzalez Colon. No, I'm not going to give you a chance to sit down, sweetheart. You're up next.
I'm always ready.
We started earlier this year at the Congressional Hispanic Leadership Institute, the chairman's circle, to have distinguished leaders, including former board members, new members, and academic university presidents join. And our representative here is one of the very first members to join the CHLI chairman's circle. So please, a round of applause for her this morning.
Thank you, and thank you for that quickly introduction.
Yeah.
I really appreciate that, and thank you for everyone to be here, for the distinguished panel for being here today, and I think it's very appropriate to have this kind of a briefing when we are discussing actually the tax reform. And as you may know, the situation regarding the island, and I will go back directly to the point. I want to thank Marianne for having this briefing, and the people of CHLI and Lincoln Diaz Barral, our founding member and a real inspiration for all of us for letting this happen. And I will go to the facts. As you may know, we had a weak economy for decades, depression for 11 years. Puerto Rico is a jurisdiction the United States with the highest poverty rate, 45% of poverty rate, and followed by Mississippi with 21.5. So these numbers are more alarming among children and young people. We got 56.9% poverty rate among those categories. The census reported that Puerto Rico has the lowest household income, $19,000 a year, compared to $39,000 in the state of Mississippi, and $53,000 a year nationwide. And the island faces an unemployment rate of 11.5%. And when you compare that, since 2011, the population decreased by 400,000 people in the last 5 years. Right now, you got 5.3 million US citizens coming from the island in the States, and then you got 3.4 million Puerto Ricans living in the island. So you got more Puerto Ricans living in the mainland than the ones living in the island. Last year, Congress went to great lengths to address the fiscal situation in the island through the enactment of Provenza. And there is a process occurring right now, actually yesterday, to allow Puerto Rico to restructure its debt. That was step number one. Step number two comes now with tax reform. And with that, the United States should create a system to play equal footing with other countries and enable U.S. businesses to invest, grow, create jobs, and create better opportunities to the people of Puerto Rico. And we are using right now, and I have to make a direct comparison with the PROMESA report that was filed in December. And I will make a direct reference to that report. That report says, first, we should make Puerto Rico integral to any future deliberations over tax reform legislation. Second, be mindful that Puerto Rico and the other territories are U.S. jurisdictions, home to U.S. citizens or nationals, and that jobs in Puerto Rico and the other territories are American jobs. Third, and lastly, the report noted, the task force is open to the prospects of Congress providing U.S. companies that invest in Puerto Rico with more competitive tax treatment as long as appropriate guardrails that are designed to ensure that companies is creating real economic activity and employment to the islands. That will mean that that task reform should include opportunities for Puerto Rico. In that regard, there are so many areas that we should discuss in this panel. One of those is the situation and the proposal to include a border adjustable tax for VAT regarding the application of that Puerto Rico. As you may know, we are part of the United States. So that should not apply to the island and to the products that are made in the island. So we should not be considered as a foreign jurisdiction to that production of those products that are made in the USA. In that regard, I should also say that we already provided and filed some of the bills that the task report recommended in December. Those bills are filed in a bipartisan mode and are the recommendations for the extension of Section 199 for domestic corporations, Section 261 to authorize the automatic enrollment of Medicare Part B, Section 24 of the Internal Revenue Code to provide same treatment to families with one child or two children, Section provide the domestic production of activities in the island, and Section 7652 of the Internal Revenue Code for their ROM cover over to the Virgin Islands and Puerto Rico. Those provisions should be included in the tax reform either. Those provisions are already recommended by the task force that for the bipartisan report on December, and I should ask this panel to include that in your discussion today. Thank you, CHLI, for having me here, and I hope this will be one of the many discussions we should have in the task force. Thank you.
We've been blessed that all the members were here at the same time, and I know it's a busy schedule, so I'm going to ask if you could please welcome the two other members of Congress to just join us on up here for right now so we can take a quick photo, get Congressman Corbello's remarks in first, and then Congressman Darren Soto's comments in second, so we can get the whole group back to work. So Congressman Corbello, please join us up here. Congressman Curvelo is one of the CHLI congressional board members from Florida. Congressman Darren Soto, a new member, also from Florida. He's another member of our CHLI chairman circle. Max, if you could join us real quick for a photo and the speakers, that way we can get them back to work as well. A ver. You want to get the... Congressman Curvelo, gracias.
Good morning. Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here with my two distinguished colleagues, Jennifer González Corón and Darren Soto, and also with these distinguished panelists who have taken of their time to discuss this very important topic. And Jennifer really did most of the work for me, because I'm a member of the Ways and Means Committee, and at our retreat this past weekend, we huddled Sunday and Monday, I brought up the topic of Puerto Rico, which had not been central to the committee's discussions up to the point. I understand that. We were dealing with big issues like interest deductibility and border adjustments and full and immediate expensing, but the committee now understands that tax reform is a great vehicle through which to help Puerto Rico, through which to help treat Puerto Rico fairly. So I'm 100% committed to all of the items that Jennifer just discussed. And by the way, let me just say that our fellow American citizens in Puerto Rico are very blessed to have this woman fighting for them here in the Congress. She is in everyone's face all the time, and that is exactly how you have to do it if you want to succeed. So give her a round of applause. And I'm also grateful to Darren. Darren's been a welcome addition to the Congress. He's someone very easy to work with, always willing to contribute, to bring ideas to the table. He also has a deep admiration and respect for Puerto Ricans, and he represents many Puerto Ricans in Central Florida. And again, we in Florida are blessed and happy to have a strong, vibrant Puerto Rican community, but we want the people of Puerto Rico to have the choice to stay on the island if that is what they want. We love for them to come to the United States if they choose to voluntarily, not because it's their only option, because the situation on the island is so dire and difficult. So we need to work together. We are working together. We will continue working together to make sure that Puerto Rico gets treated fairly. Two major policy areas, healthcare and taxes. I, thankfully, am in a good position to help. In this last omnibus, the Medicaid funding was a major priority for me, and I have to give our speaker, Paul Ryan, credit. He stayed firm. He said this was important. There was some opposition, but the speaker said that we need to do this for Puerto Rico, and we got it done, and we hope that that model will persist in the future. So thank you all, and I hope you have a wonderful discussion this morning. Marianne, if it's okay with you, I will introduce my colleague and friend from Central Florida, Darren Soto.
First of all, thank you, Congressman Curbelo and Commissioner Gonzalez. They've both been huge champions up here and very easy to work with, especially in an age where you see some things get partisan. You saw a budget yesterday that Democrats and Republicans came together on. And I want to start by just discussing that briefly, you know, with the governor finally declaring Title III remedies, and now it goes to the PROMESA board. And Commissioner and I both sit on the Natural Resources Subcommittee on Indian Peninsula and Alaskan Lands, which has jurisdiction over it. We'll obviously be watching carefully that progression. And we both chose to be on there for a specific reason, to be there for moments just like this, where our island is going to need our help. And they'll have $295 million more dollars to be able to work with as they're guiding through and protecting the people of Puerto Rico during this very difficult time. You know, we learned, I think, over the history of the island, two important lessons when it comes to tax reform. First is that having trickle-down economic tax reform does not work. It may speed us forward, but then it sets us back. And we saw that with the up and down roller coaster of 936. And so I think the first thing that I'll be looking for is making sure it's all about power to the people, which is our second lesson. And a lot of those reforms, some of which we've co-sponsored together already, we need to make sure that if we're going to do tax reform to help benefit the people of Puerto Rico, that it goes directly to the people. And so the first thing we'll be looking at is the child tax credit. Right now it's for the third or more children in a family in Puerto Rico, which many of us believe was a Scrivener's error, unless there's a federal policy to want Puerto Ricans to have at least three children or more, which is five. But I'm thinking that we need to start it from the first child and make sure our peers understand this was an error in statutory drafting that needs to be fixed. It's actually silly that we haven't had that fixed yet. The second issue is, and it also strengthens the family. We want families in Puerto Rico to be able to make it. We want to make sure that when a couple gets married that they're incentivized to have a family and continue well-needed growth in Puerto Rico. The second issue, obviously, is their income tax credit. You know, our brothers and sisters on the island, they pay Social Security, they pay Medicare, and I believe if we're really going to push to have an incentive to work, we use programs that have been working all over America that have been working for years, including the Earned Income Tax Credit. And I think we have to apply that to make sure that, again, it's power of the people, incentivizing the people of Puerto Rico, which I believe are, in the long term, going to be the solution to prosperity. And then we're also going to be looking at other things that may or may not fit under the tax discussion, but I think they go into this idea of assisting with prosperity. I would like to see us open up more SBA and agricultural loans for the island. A lot of people who follow the history know that before the federal government came in at the turn of the last century, Puerto Rico had many small, prosperous farmers, and the peso was actually at the same level as the dollar when the United States invaded the island. And so I think we have to look at some of the basics from our history that have worked, which is getting more people to go into agriculture. I know a lot of folks, when the pharmaceutical industry and the banking industry started really coming to prominence, like my own family, started working for a lot of those companies and left our agricultural roots. My family has 60 acres on the side of a hill in Sabana Hoyos that no one for a generation has used. And that tells me that this is a story throughout. In Florida, particularly in my district, in Orange, Osceola, and Polk County, millionaires are made through agriculture. You may have drank some Florida orange juice, some of you, I'm sure at some point or other. We are also a large beef producer. I think there's a lot of opportunity, whether it be in specialty crops like mangoes or papaya, or with coffee, which is already world famous from Puerto Rico, or so many of these other specialty fruits and vegetables that can grow full year-round in Puerto Rico. We need to incentivize this through more aggressive ag loans, and I'll also be asking through the Department of Interior to look at whether federal lands that may be on the island can be leased back. And we want it to be small farmers. We want folks to be able to enter in who otherwise were working in other industries. And then with regard to SBA loans, we want to encourage more entrepreneurship. We want to make sure that that 22-year-old kid that comes out of University of Puerto Rico with a good idea has access to capital and the ability to start that next large business that may start small, but through the amazing world of the internet and this high-tech economy that we have going forward, these are going to be the types of firms that help lead us out. And so I think we have to make sure to look at well-established programs that have worked in other states, like the child tax credit, like the earned income tax credit, like SBA loans, like agricultural loans, and really give the people of Puerto Rico these options to succeed. And I know with the hard work ethic of so many on the island that they will. And so I look forward to working with Commissioner Gonzalez and Congressman Cabrera. Corbello and so many others to have power of the people and make sure that we empower the people of Puerto Rico to bring the island back to prosperity. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
Once again, let's thank the three members of Congress that have laid out today the framework of a positive vision for how incentivizing growth in Puerto Rico, private sector being in charge of moving forward through the incentives that a new tax reform that applies for the entire country can also benefit Puerto Rico. And let me tell you, this is no small initiative. Tax reform is very complicated, but the president has tweeted, big tax reform, tax reduction. His chief economic advisor, Gary Cohn, has written, we have once in a generation opportunity to do something big. President Trump has made tax reform a priority, and we have a Republican Congress that wants to get it done. This is something that Democrats should support too, because he said it's good for the American people. I completely agree with that statement. It is good for the American people, and therefore it's good for Puerto Rico. There is nowhere in the US that is in more need of measures to stimulate private capital, to invest, and to grow the economy and create jobs than Puerto Rico. So I'm looking forward to our panelists' presentations this morning on how can federal tax reform be the pro-business path for economic development in Puerto Rico. A business-led approach that is one of the most potentially rewarding paths for the island's economic growth, which may allow for Puerto Rico to meet its obligations to its citizens and others. So with that, I want to introduce briefly all three panelists, and then I'll lay out the order for the panelists to begin. I want to first introduce the bio of Honorable Rosana Cruz Rivera. Deputy Secretary Cruz is an experienced tax attorney with over 15 years of experience in both the private and public sector. Her previous service includes being the Legislative Affairs and Tax Director for the Puerto Rico Industrial Development Company within the Puerto Rico Department of Economic Development. Deputy Secretary Cruz holds a bachelor's degree in accounting with cum laude recognition from the University of Puerto Rico's Mayagüez campus, a law degree from the University of Puerto Rico School of Law, where she achieved magna cum laude honors, and a master's of law in taxation from New York University's School of Law. Mr. Roman is the president of Stratec LLC. He has over 30 years of experience in the pharmaceutical industry, including with GSK, MOVA, and Pfizer. For several years, Mr. Roman has served as a member of the Board of Directors of the Pharmaceutical Industry of Puerto Rico, in Puerto Rico known as PIA, and the Puerto Rico Manufacturers Association. Bless you. He holds a bachelor's degree in industrial engineering and a master's in business from the University of Puerto Rico. Mr. Pete Sepp. Mr. Sepp is the president of the nonprofit, nonpartisan National Taxpayers Union, also known as NTU. Mr. Sepp has been with NTU since 1988. During this time, he has written numerous policy papers, publications, and manuals, testified before Congress, lectured on issues such as tax, administration reform, including the aspects of PROMESA. Before coming to NTU, Mr. Sepp served with the St. Louis County Board of Elections and with the U.S. Senate. Mr. Sepp graduated cum laude from Webster University. So in today's, this morning, we will have first Mr. Sepp give 3 minutes remarks, followed by Mr. Ivan, and finally with Undersecretary Rosana Cruz. I want to make sure that you understand that it's 3 minutes. I will not tap the water glass. I will not tap the podium. I will say time. And with that, Mr. Sen, you have the floor.
And I'll speak extra quickly, Max. Thank you. Allow me to read one thing here. Any sustainable solution to Puerto Rico's dire fiscal situation must include the enactment of pro-growth policies for the island. That came directly from the Trump administration in its statement of administration policy on the omnibus appropriations bill. You couldn't tweet that. Too many characters, too many words. But it's an important statement because I think it is indicating a shift in emphasis here in Washington toward the recognition that economic growth must be the paramount strategy in order to help our U.S. citizens in Puerto Rico, 3.5 million of them, to develop their economy again. Why is National Taxpayers Union so concerned with this? Well, for one, we have an abiding interest in ensuring that troubled states, localities, and territories of the United States are given the fiscal tools they need to allow the private sector working with citizens to buoy their own economies. Puerto Rico is in dire need of those tools. We also have members in Puerto Rico. My parents have lived in Puerto Rico. I have many great memories of visiting the island. All of these things are reasons why we are involved. And why is tax reform so important to this question of economic development? Because it is the one greatest thing we can do to tear down barriers to entry for families to take care of themselves, for small businesses to prosper, and for large businesses and individuals to invest in the island's economy. As Max said, tax reform on the federal level can include Puerto Rico. It must. There are elements of the tax reform plans, however, moving through the House of Representatives that have particular relevance and applicability to Puerto Rico. Among these are the elements of repatriation of income, money that might be sitting in places abroad that we want to bring back into the United States. The idea of territoriality, how when a U.S. corporation is operating overseas in a foreign country, it's double taxed. There are also elements of removing tax complexity, the fact that we spend 7 billion hours complying with the current tax system, two-thirds of which is attributable to small and large businesses. Set aside this crazy argument that, oh, Puerto Rican citizens and of the United States don't pay income taxes. Well, we can argue back and forth about that. They pay other taxes too. But the fact is, such a massive amount of this complexity and compliance burden is related to businesses. Cut into that burden and you help businesses on the island and across the entire United States. We can incorporate all of these principles of repatriation, territoriality, and simplification in a tax reform package that can directly benefit Puerto Rico. We may have to adjust certain provisions in any given tax reform plan to reflect the historical realities of how our tax system has treated Puerto Rico. There may be other proposals ranging from enterprise zones to others developed both on and off the island that deserve consideration. And of course, the recommendations of the Bipartisan Task Force on Economic Growth have to be taken into account. The message I want to leave you with in these brief remarks is this. National Taxpayers Union cares about this issue deeply for all of the reasons that I have stated, and we are not going to leave this debate alone. Congressman Curbelo has made a fantastic start on behalf of the people of Puerto Rico in the Tax Writing Committee, insisting that the needs of Puerto Rico be taken into account in any tax reform plan. We are going to echo that message across the United States to our members, to other citizens, and demand fair, equal treatment for the citizens of this great island.
And that's Tani.
Now, I will follow, would like Mr. Ivan Roman to make a brief statement.
Yeah, good morning, and thanks for the opportunity for being with you here today. What I want to do in this first opportunity to talk to you is to give you what I believe is a true perspective of what the pharmaceutical industry means for Puerto Rico today. So there are some, I would say, conceptions and misconceptions about what the industry is doing and has been doing for decades in the island. And the first thing I want to mention is that the industry initially first came to Puerto Rico driven by incentives like the ones that can be provided by the new tax reform currently under discussion in the island. So it was a combination of local and federal incentives that give us, the Puerto Ricans, the opportunity to learn about this industry and construct what we have been able to construct over about five decades now. So Puerto Rico has become, through this opportunity, one of the countries with the highest concentration of pharmaceutical manufacturing in the world, including the United States. And significant, I will split in three different groups: technical, leadership, and executive expertise has been able to be constructed in Puerto Rico. So I remember when the industry started in Puerto Rico, most of the general managers came from different places around the world today. Most of the leadership of the pharmaceutical operations in Puerto Rico are Puerto Ricans. Next, I want to share with you what the industry means for Puerto Rico in numbers, and it's where I believe there are some misunderstandings and misconceptions. So the industry represents 30% of Puerto Rico GDP today. To give you some perspective, tourism, which many people believe is what we should focus on or is the largest GDP contributor to Puerto Rico, is only 7%. And in the last 4 years has been duplicated. So 4 years ago it was only 4%, and the industry 30. The number of jobs created by the industry in the combination of direct and indirect jobs is over 80,000 jobs. 18,000 being direct jobs, and these are highly compensated and high-skilled jobs for people like me that invest all my professional career in the industry, and many other Puerto Ricans. And over 60,000 indirect jobs, which are not only indirect jobs, but I also specialize indirect jobs, and there are many companies, which if I would have more than 3 minutes, I can talk about that. But many companies that has been constructed in Puerto Rico and even expanding operations across the world because of this industry being in Puerto Rico. And then the fiscal contribution, especially in the context of the fiscal challenges we are having in the island. Many people say that the industry do not pay taxes, but we pay $3 billion in taxes annually to the Puerto Rico government, which is more than a third of all the income received by the Puerto Rico government today from any source. And last but not least, the asset base, the capital investment of the industry in the island is over $10 billion, and just in maintaining this asset base, we invest over $700 million annually just in maintaining the asset base we have and what I call the installed capacity we have in the island. So the presence of this industry in Puerto Rico has been critical to Puerto Rico's socio-economic development at any point in time over those five decades. But at the point we are today, I don't need to talk about where we stand as a country from the fiscal standpoint, it's critical that within this tax reform, considerations are taken to assure that we retain the industry we have been able to construct, but also we build over this installed capacity that we have constructed and expand beyond that.
Time. Very good. Now, we will follow with Deputy Secretary Cruz Rivera.
From the Puerto Rico Treasury standpoint, we see the department as an essential element for Puerto Rico to achieving its financial goals. We are, and to be very precise, we are in charge to raise the revenues needed to meet the requirements of the recently certified fiscal plan. However, we don't see the department as a merit collector. We know that we will not be able to reach those goals if we don't have economic growth. We're 100% certain on that. And as my initial remarks, I wanted to give you a couple of facts or backgrounds on how Puerto Rico taxes work. And as you all know, Puerto Rico is a territory of the United States. Domestic, essentially, in every sense. However, the U.S. Internal Revenue Code treats Puerto Rico as a unique jurisdiction in many respects. We have our own code, and our code follows or is modeled after the U.S. code version of 1939. For us, the interaction between the U.S. code and the Puerto Rico code as they are right now is essential. It's very important, and based on that model, many individuals and companies have invested in Puerto Rico and are currently doing business in Puerto Rico. So that if any of those elements change, we will have a direct impact on our economic base or our baseline, to call it that way. To give you an example of that interaction, for example, I will say, as the commissioner mentioned, the Puerto Rico individuals or Puerto Rico residents are subject to Social Security and Medicare withholdings like every residence in a state of the United States. Puerto Rico residents do pay income tax on their U.S. source income and are not required to file U.S. income tax returns solely on their Puerto Rico source income. Corporations on the other side that are organized in Puerto Rico are not considered domestic under the U.S. Internal Revenue Code. That gives you an idea of how, of the distinct interaction of both set of rules and how important for us is to continue with that harmony and how the business operations and even individuals residing in Puerto Rico depend on that harmony. I'll give you more details on how we see the proposed changes to the code. However, the way we see this is that the mere discussion of a proposed reform creates an impact in Puerto Rico. Even though we don't have a statute written yet, we don't have a specific language, it creates uncertainty. So we are here. It's not the first time that we are in Congress, and it's not going to be the last. We're going to follow closely this progress, and what we really need is that Puerto Rico is being taken in consideration as any other state, the U.S. in that process.
Thank you. So, as we're all aware, thank you very much all for your presentations. And I think you're setting the right parameters for the discussion that we're going to have here in Congress and eventually in Puerto Rico as well. Puerto Rico has been on the news lately, and we're all aware of that. But we're here about talking about the future of the United States, economic growth, and the future of Puerto Rico as well within that process. So I want to ask first Pete, why are we having this in the first place? Why are we having the tax debate or the need for tax reform debate here in the United States? Why is that?
I think because it has been forced upon us by the very system that's collapsing under its own weight. As I mentioned, with a $7 billion compliance burden, with the fact that we have very high rates that are not competitive with those of other countries, both for businesses to a lesser degree, on individuals, the fact that there are tax authorities around the world pursuing American businesses, especially from the European Union, in a way that is tremendously disadvantaging the ability of our businesses to conduct their matters overseas. All of these things are coming together to essentially force Congress to confront the question, and this is the ideal time for it to occur.
So let me ask then, Ivan, if tax reform is good for the U.S. industries, is it also good for those employed or potentially employed by them and Puerto Rico?
As I said before, it's extremely important to protect the jobs that we have, the specialized, high compensated, high skilled jobs that we have, but also to create a scenario to expand over the installed capacity that we have in the island. So within the tax reform, tools should be put in place to assure that Puerto Rico gets a competitive advantage that actually stimulates the economic growth that manufacturing in general, but in particular the pharmaceutical industry, can bring into the island.
And taking that, or basically following up on that, Rosanna, how do you see that having a tax reform, having an impact in the daily lives of the people in Puerto Rico?
As I mentioned in the initial remarks, the mere discussions of fiscal reform creates uncertainty. It's been our experience that companies are coming to us telling us, like, look, we're not going to expand now, we're not going to invest now, because we don't know what's going to happen. On the other side, if, for instance, a border adjustment tax is finally enacted, without taking into consideration that Puerto Rico is a U.S. territory of the United States and that we manufacture U.S. products and that those products are manufactured by U.S. citizens, that could be devastating for our economy. Mm. But it could also, on the other side, if it's drafted in a way that all those elements are taken into consideration, could really help our economy.
And the people will live, how do you think the people will benefit in terms of what Ivan was mentioning about the expansion of growth and jobs?
Again, what we are hoping is to retain those jobs and to increase those jobs. And I would think that that could be a good result for Puerto Rico if it's treated in the best way possible.
I think that would be fantastic if we can manage to do that. And I think that's part of the debate that we're going to start today. With this forum, and thanks to all of you. So, Pete, how do you see, and I think you alluded this to in the earlier part of your presentation, so how this benefits the country, and how do we go from greater revenue and promoting investments and by the end result creating jobs, how we go there, how we get through this process?
Well, the first thing to do is to remember to keep tax rates as low as possible, but while keeping the rates as low as possible, allowing more money to remain in the hands of small business creators, families, even larger businesses that might seek to invest, we also have to simplify the base of taxation. In other words, the type of income we intend to apply the rate to. That is an incredibly complex subject, especially for the business side of the tax system. One of the key features of the House blueprint on tax reform is to allow for what's called full expensing, which means when you buy a piece of equipment or make some other kind of investment, you can immediately deduct that full amount in the year that you purchase it, instead of having to do what's called depreciation over 30, 40 years in some cases. That alone has been attributed as the source for something like half of the accountants and staff members in large businesses just keeping track of it. If we were to simplify that, we would dramatically increase the ability of businesses to invest. And again, Puerto Rico is 100 times worse off than the rest of the United States when it comes to some of these issues and these problems. It is of the utmost urgency that Congress recognize this and make the maximum improvements possible to benefit the island as quickly as possible. That is one of my greatest fears, that Congress will once again, as unfortunately they did in PROMESA, say, well, we'll worry about some of these problems at another point. We can't legislate on this right now. Well, it is now. It's long past now. And something has to move forward quickly.
I completely agree. The timing is, we cannot delay this any longer. Especially, and I want Ivan to jump in on this. Why people who are interested in Puerto Rico's economic fate should support pro-growth tax initiatives at this juncture?
The first thing I want to mention in that sense is that I hope from any one perspective, having manufacturing activity means creating value versus transferring value as maybe in other type of industries. So manufacturing as an economic development tool, again, I hope for all of us is a no-brainer. As I said before, we have built the know-how, the expertise for this particular industry and many others, but I am talking about the pharma industry. And in my view, being able to construct over something you are proven in doing good or extraordinarily good is a better strategy than trying to start something else from zero, which I believe we need in Puerto Rico anyway, in terms of expanding and diversifying the sources of income for the government. But in this particular industry, again, we are proven. So having a tax reform that allow us to quickly build over that platform that has been constructed over the decades, for me, is the right way to go.
Oh, thank you. And Rosanna, I think one of the questions that people who are not from Puerto Rico but live and work here in Washington, D.C. and in Congress and across the country, they basically will have one question, which is, why is an economically healthy Puerto Rico also good for the U.S.? What is the importance of including Puerto Rico in any U.S. overall tax reform?
For me, it's very obvious, but I'll tell you. I think that Puerto Rico's stability and fiscal health is as important as the stability of any other state. So the economic growth of states and U.S. territories are very important to the nation. Yeah. And it has a direct impact on the overall wellness of the nation.
And I think that's a point that sometimes it gets lost in the debate, and I think Pete had mentioned, sometimes in terms of the Puerto Rico issues, the natural fallback position sometimes in the Washington is, well, we have some pressing matters, we'll tackle that later. And we don't have that luxury anymore. And as we tackle national issues, that national issue has also to include Puerto Rico. I mean, For those of you who are not too familiar with the circumstances in Puerto Rico, even though you may have heard that a lot of people, as Congressman D'Arezzo mentioned, a lot of people are now residing in Florida. Puerto Rico still has 3.4 million people living on the island. That's still a larger population than 22 states. Think about that. Puerto Rico, some people may be trying to project it in a very negative light lately, but Puerto Rico still has a strong infrastructure that needs modernizing, of course, like the U.S. does. Puerto Rico has a lot of industries residing in Puerto Rico, medical devices, pharmaceutical, aerospace, information technology. Puerto Rico is not some outpost that nobody knows where it is. Puerto Rico is on the map. We just need to put it again as a shining spot on the map. So before I allow and open it up for questions for a colleague, I want for the panelists a little bit to react to what each of one have said. Each one have a particular set of expertise and views on how this debate moves forward in Washington. But I want to get if you have any comments or reactions to what each one of you have said. And I'll start with Pete.
Well, I think Yvonne's comment that you have to add value to an economy for long-term economic growth is important to keep in mind. That can come from manufacturing, it can come from other sectors, but unless we focus on providing the policies that encourage long-term investment. All of these events that we're witnessing now, for example, with Title III of PROMESA being invoked and investor worries that the island may be headed for some other kind of uncertainty, unless we find a way to reduce uncertainty in other areas of policy, and tax policy can be one of them, and that of course is a comment that Roxana brought up, the uncertainty of tax reform. It affects everyone here in the United States and the continental US, and in Puerto Rico especially. And again, members of Congress have their own timetable for tax reform, but we have to be sure that we provide them with our timetable and encourage them to keep working. It would have been very easy for the Trump administration, for example, to just say, well, we'll shave a few points off the tax rate and we'll all go home happy. But they said, no, we want something comprehensive. That's an opportunity and we have to seize it.
I am going to follow the same line and be very brief, but from my perspective, what Rosanna mentioned of the importance of having certainty, for me is the key element of what she mentioned, because we are going through also a local tax reform in Puerto Rico. And we are having the U.S. tax reform, and because of the relationship between both continental U.S. and Puerto Rico, how we put together both reforms in a way that promotes the growth that we need is very important. And even though that represents an opportunity, during the time we are having the discussion, it creates uncertainty because nobody knows where this is going to be ending up. So, I think that we need to continue doing what we are doing today, educating decision makers on what Puerto Rico is and what Puerto Rico brings into the table, to assure that whatever the end result of the process is, eliminates the uncertainty and creates an environment that promotes growth to the island.
To those remarks.
Now, on the side of the U.S. tax reform, the fact that Puerto Rico hasn't been specifically mentioned in any of the pronouncements creates that certainty. And the way we fail in Puerto Rico is that we don't have a drawing board to draw. However, we're doing our part. As Ivan mentioned, we are working on a package of legislation to also simplify our code. When I saw the goals of President Trump's goals for purposes of the tax reform, we're in line with those goals in a sense that we want to simplify the code and we're working on that. We want to provide pro-growth to Puerto Rico. At this point, we cannot reduce the tax rates, but that is our goal in the long run. So the way we feel is that we will be ready to react fast to any changes in legislation. However, we need that drawing board. We need to have specific guidance and specific provisions that allow us to work and that secure the treatment that our jurisdiction needs in order to do that.
And I think, Pete, just one last question before I open that for the audience. But the issue of tax reform requires bipartisan support. I mean, these are a national issue, so both parties should be more than eager to at least try to work together on this issue. How do you foresee a bipartisan approach moving forward, even within the House version and the White House version? There may be some disagreements, but that's just part of the initial first round, don't you think?
Yes, it is. And I would think that Senate Democrats especially would have a lot to contribute about business tax reform. Of course, there have been some prominent sponsors and there's been some prominent interest among Democrats in some of the tax reform ideas that have been promoted that are specifically aimed at Puerto Rico. I know Senator Wyden, who is the ranking minority member of the Senate Finance Committee, has expressed an interest in a repatriation type proposal that would specifically involve Puerto Rico. We also, in my opinion, should not overlook the possibility for some action, not only by Congress, but by the executive branch itself. One of my colleagues, Ryan Ellis, who is a columnist for Forbes magazine, recently wrote a very interesting article about how the Internal Revenue Service and the Treasury Department have certain prerogatives to define issues in the tax system that could make tax filing much easier for small businesses, perhaps help to alter some of the regulations, things that can be deductible. They're called safe harbors. And perhaps the private sector in Puerto Rico, which has experience with the U.S. federal tax code, could develop an inventory of issues that could be taken to the Trump administration, and potentially there might be some items that the administration could move forward with by executive order very quickly.
That's a very interesting proposition. I think I'm going to open it up for questions. I would please encourage you to formulate it in a question. I know it sounds like I'm being redundant, but no. I've been through this rodeo a few times. I may have been guilty of that myself, but I am trying to keep to have as many questions as I can from the audience. So I'll open up the floor and just raise your hand, please. Yes. Please identify yourself.
Hi, Gretchen Sierra Zarita. The territories are always taking the crumbs of whatever is going on in Washington. In this case, is tax reform. This whole notion of repatriation may offer the territories a chance to wean themselves somewhat from the federal resources and create economic growth within the territories. Can you talk about the challenges in Congress to craft a proposal that would make the territories into a repatriation point for the profits of American companies, and what kind of interest groups would be for and against this type of proposal? Is that short enough?
Short enough.
Well, again, we don't have a specific proposal yet. We don't see a special tax or a special treatment for repatriation. We don't see any problem with that. And if that that tax money that now the federal government will receive as a result of that bill could definitely help us in some way, and maybe a special tax rate applicable to the companies that are in Puerto Rico. Applicable to those repatriations, that could be another opportunity too. But we just see opportunities in that type of initiative.
Anyone else?
Well, there have been some proposals outlined for repatriation that could pretty easy is a relative term, be adopted into a tax reform plan. There have been several laws in the past, the Jobs Creation Act, for example, that provided an 85% dividend exemption for repatriation. It would not be that difficult to fashion such a thing that would apply to territories and uniformly as well. It remains shocking that different territories have different treatments, not just territories versus states in the United States, and it is a patchwork of laws that needs to be confronted. One of the biggest hurdles, it's members of Congress, unfortunately, who continue to have misconceptions about the relationship between the territories and the United States in terms of tax treatment. The tax writers certainly have a good grasp of it. The Joint Tax Committee has written excellent documents about it, but who outside of those committees and the rest of Congress has studied up on that, not many.
Any further questions? Then Bartolet.
Good morning, Pedro Torres Diaz of the Hispanic National Bar Association. Thank you for your presentation. Can you discuss of the measures that you're seeing being discussed for the economic development of Puerto Rico, which is so important? What, in your opinion, will work, but also what, in your opinion, will not work? And also, when we talk about tax reform, are you all looking at a return to Section 936 or something similar to that?
Don't be shy.
In relation to your first question, which I believe is that what I think will work and what will not. The most important thing I believe is that Puerto Rico, through this tax reform, get what I call an economic development tool, which means that it has to be a mechanism through which economic development activity in Puerto Rico is promoted as part of the legislation, but not only to Puerto Rico, to all the states. We need to come back then to the reality that Puerto Rican jobs are U.S. jobs, and part of the policy of the President Trump is to bring back to America manufacturing jobs. So in my view, the key is how we can build over that, I would say, strategic direction from the President in terms of bringing back manufacturing jobs to the United States and putting Puerto Rico in a competitive position to be able to attract from foreign jurisdictions some of these jobs that we are able to take place in Puerto Rico.
From the Treasury Department standpoint, and as I described in my initial remarks, for us it's important to keep that balance, the balance of the interaction of the U.S. code and the Puerto Rico code. That's the way we see it. And that balance, we need to all know that balance was taken into consideration by the business that are already in Puerto Rico, and that they made their fiscal or financial plans for 4 and 10 years. So they made their plans based on that structure. And what we need to do is to keep that structure and that interaction at balance. That's the way we see it.
Any further questions?
Andy Blum, I'm the D.C. Director for Fundación Libertad, Puerto Rican think tank. We're talking about a lot of this in light of Congress dealing with tax reform, but Puerto Rico's situation is fairly urgent, and tax reform alone in Puerto Rico is not the answer. But would it be better from Puerto Rico's perspective to separate this out from the ongoing tax reform, which could become another health care bill, and try to get action by, you know, a package of direct suggestions for Puerto Rico? Would it be potentially better for Puerto Rico if we were to view Puerto Rico as a cut congressional issue as opposed to including it in tax reform?
Well, I think we certainly have to elevate it to a level of urgency even beyond the urgency of reforming the overall system. Perhaps the best way we can do that is to make sure that the tax writing committees themselves hold hearings on issues specific to the territories and tax policy. There's just, of course, a raging debate over Section 936. I won't get into that, but Senator Hatch, of course, has said that he thinks the repeal of that section had something to do with the economic decline. Others disagree, but those issues are not generally discussed in the committees that would have the most jurisdiction over them. And we heard tax and economic growth proposals for Puerto Rico, repatriation arrangements, for example, in testimony before the Natural Resources Committee. It was good to get that out, but you're not going to have the technical discussions about how legislation would work with these issues unless you hold the hearings inside the tax writing committees. If we do that now, we have the advantage of either incorporating it into a bigger tax reform bill as it moves through Congress, or in targeted legislation if it looks like it's going to stall.
Any further questions?
We don't know about the future. Mr. Ortiz, I'm a proud resident of Puerto Rico, a member of the industry. We don't know what's going to happen in the future, but we do know what happened in the past. I just wanted to have peace and some of you. When you look back, what do you think that is the view here that has been the impact of all those incentives that were given in the past? Because just a short comment. For me, it's, you know, it's represent the opportunity to be, you know, a Puerto Rican that contribute to the country and to, you know, make my money. So I wonder if inside the communities they have looked at that and they have looked what has happened to Puerto Rico. This is the only sector that is growing, this is the only sector that continues to contribute. And the question would be, as you look forward, you know, how can you compete or see what's happened in the past, in the future? I mean, what is the opinion inside it? You are aware of that, you know, how much they know of how this sector of incentives has done in the past.
Maybe I do want to add a remark regarding to the previous question. I think we need all the help that we can get. However, we will like, we know, and we know that we cannot get like results in piecemeal. We would like to have an entire set of rules and a whole result help for our situation. And in terms of what has happened in the past, my experience while we visited Congress last time is that, yes, Congressman and their staff know a lot about Puerto Rico. However, what they have seen most recently is this fiscal situation, is PROMESA. So we need to educate, first overcome that situation and give them the assurance that we are taking the steps necessary to comply and get through the situation, and at the same time give them our initiatives and our proposals to be part of an entire reform that could be beneficial for all.
I definitely agree with that, and the tax history, of course, still resides primarily with those who had experience with the 936 repeal. Senator Hatch is still here, a few others, but it is clouded by the current fiscal crisis and investor uncertainty over how debts will be restructured. And all of these things are weighing very heavily on many members of Congress.
Well, we have time for one more question before I'm being told time. one more question. Yes.
Hi, Alejandro Hernandez. I am a law student at GW, and I have an interest in tax. And I have a question. So the situation is dire and it's urgent, so like action is needed now. So I just fear like what are the best steps that you think in terms of creating a reform and creating plans and action that will have long-term effects, not just something now that we need, I was talking before, like the 936, it was ups and downs and things like that. So how do we make sure that actually everything that is enacted now and everything moving forward would actually have long-term effects? And not only long-term effects, but also like long-term effects in Puerto Rico, not just for corporations that come in and invest and things like that.
I think what it needs is deep knowledge of Puerto Rico, of who we are, where we stand, what do we need to be in the same level as a state. The thing that we see this is that we cannot be compared to a state, neither we can be compared to a foreign jurisdiction. We are in a disadvantaged position. We are an economically depressed jurisdiction, so we need to be taken into consideration and have a deep conversation and analysis where in every sentence of that code. So it's not something simple. Maybe a comma or a point here or there can make a huge difference for us. So it's a very complicated process, and we are all here to sit down with congressmen and to staffers to make sure that the impact of this reform, that the impact of each word on that code does not hurt us. That is all that we want. Just don't hurt Puerto Rico. Help us be in the same level of playing field. That's all we want.
Ivan, from the industry perspective, any final comments?
Just as I said before, the need of that economic development tool to be able to construct over, you know, what we have built over the years, and second, the certainty of what are the conditions to invest in Puerto Rico. So that's the relevance of getting this process as fast as we can.
Anything else, Pete? Well, in that case, I want to thank the panelists, and I will hope that the audience will join me in giving a warm applause for all the excellent presentations. And now I will yield back the podium back to Mary Ann, and I want to thank Mary Ann and the CHLI board and all the members and the family of CHLI for giving me the opportunity to moderate this panel. Thank you.
I just want to close and thank all of you again for participating. Like in anything else, once you have information and you've heard from the speakers and our moderator, it's basically our obligation to do something with that information and not just sit here and listen and nod and tweet, but actually do something about it. Which means you heard from three members of Congress today, bipartisan support. It's not about them. This is about us. This is about our family and friends in Puerto Rico, our colleagues, our co-workers, people here in this room. It's our obligation to educate and inform the members of Congress. That's why we do this, and that's why it's important that you help us as well as help those members. The members who were here took the time and their busy day to make sure that they support us. Let's do our part by supporting them and our friends in Puerto Rico. Gracias.